Ever since we were younger, our minds are trained to have this perfect image of what we're supposed to look like. It's advertised everywhere, commercials, magazines, and even in toys. Each day, multiple times a day, we are bombarded with weight loss ads and programs to make you look skinny, because it's a multi-billion dollar industry that preys on the fear of being fat. Sexy, but it's causing me shame. I wanna lean on your shoulder. I wish I was alive, but I don't wanna cause any pain.
The Barbie doll, for example, is a perfect example of manufacturers displaying an unrealistic image of the perfect girl. Barbie dolls are made to have the perfect hair, body, a thigh gap, and a full face of makeup. Not only are the dolls a representation of the perfect girl, but she has the perfect boyfriend to go along with her. Why is this image implanted into little girls' brains? As children grow up and put their Barbies away, they start to have new unrealistic expectations. Magazines, TV, and social media are just a few examples. Once girls start to see this, they try to achieve the goal of perfection. Many young teenagers look at fashion magazines, watch TV shows such as America's Next Top Model, or even walk into stores such as Abercrombie or Victoria's Secret, and are instantly discouraged and start to create a bad body image of themselves.
What we have come up with to answer this question is that models feel the pressure from the modeling agencies who tell them to constantly lose weight so they can fit into the ultra-tiny sample size the fashion companies give them. This extreme pressure to be successful and to attain modeling jobs becomes a competition between models. It becomes a vicious cycle of dieting, being praised temporarily, and constantly being told to lose more weight. Then, once these models are placed in magazines, teenage girls look at them and get the idea that skin and bones is beauty, which is not the case. Also, the models suffer greatly as their health starts to deteriorate.
Fashion Week has become a powerful voice which reaches millions of people across the globe, and we should not underestimate the consequences of the messages that we send. It's also reasonable to say that exposure could be a huge factor in the development of eating disorders.
Everything that we see in magazines or on TV is fake. Everything has been tweaked, smoothed out, or plumped up. To ban the occasional ad because a model is too thin will have little to no effect. The industry needs labor and business laws. There needs to be laws in place enabling all models to see doctors. There are people who tell you if you need to gain or lose weight, what to do with your hair, and what other changes your body needs.
In February, California Assemblyman Mark Levine introduced a bill trying to solve this issue. It would establish health and safety regulations and other basic protections to safeguard the rights of working models. The bill clarifies that modeling agencies must be licensed and regulated as talented agencies and that models are employees, not independent contractors.
There is no excuse for requiring a model to have a diet of only one rice cake per day as a prerequisite to getting a job. It is unconscionable to look the other way as models swallow cotton balls soaked in orange juice to deal with hunger pains and the physical effects of starvation. It is unforgivable to require fashion models to go through hell in the hopes of having a successful career in modeling.
Christy Swaddling started idolizing Victoria's Secret model Miranda Kerr at age 12. This obsession of having the perfect figure led Christy to extreme dieting at a very young age. She states in an interview that they all have a figure that isn't sustainable or achievable, but it makes every girl try their hardest to lose weight. Christie was influenced by the unattainable figure that every model had. She is one of the thousands of women who experienced an awful body image due to the eating disorder-consumed modeling industry. Although she was not a model who was constantly put down by her agencies, her battle with anorexia almost became deadly.
I live my life in chains, got my hands in chains, and I can't stick with a car to the guy, but I don't like this. I must insist that a girl's got more to do than be the way you think a woman should. I'm taking it into my own hands. In this man's land, I can't understand why I'm taking command. I've had enough of stuff, and now it's time to think about me.
Rosemary told us how models have become so obsessed with being skinny. So we wanted to sit down with somebody who has been affected by this.
Hello. Hi, how are you?
Hi, Jessica. Nice to meet you.
And I'm Casey.
When we walked in, we were all shocked. We didn't expect her to be so skinny. You could see her bones.
Thank you for taking the time to sit with us.
Isabel is trying to overcome that disorder of anorexia, so I wanted to sit down and just hear her story.
Isabel Caro is as shocking a poster girl as you will ever see. Last month, the anorexic woman who weighs less than 70 pounds appeared on billboards in Milan, the fashion center of Italy. Looking at her made us wonder if she would actually survive.
A model who was not as fortunate was Isabella Caro. Isabella Caro was a young model from France whose death took much longer to be seriously noted and to become public. In 2007, when Caro agreed to shoot her emaciated naked photo to bring awareness to the horrors of anorexia, the posters were banned in many countries. Isabella told CBS News that she agreed to pose for the campaign because, "I said if I can put my years of suffering to good use, then it will not have been pointless. I know it's a shocking photo. I want it to shock. It's really a warning that is a serious illness." When Isabella took the photo shoot, she was only 59 pounds. Isabella is one of the thousands of women and men who haven't been strong enough to fight the disease. On November 17, 2010, Caro died at age 28 while being treated with an acute respiratory illness. It's sad to see how tremendous the amount of pressure is just to pursue the career of modeling. It amazes me how the modeling industry can become so toxic that it leads women to feel like you're not beautiful or worth receiving modeling business unless you're a skeleton. And in Isabella's case, it led to death. What went wrong?
In an interview with Jessica Simpson, it's crazy that Isabella says that not one person in the industry, not her agency or even her mom, tried to help her. They just continued hiring her for modeling businesses and allowed her to wither away to nothing.
That was really sad to me. The pressure you feel when someone is telling you that you need to be skinny or you could look better, you know, I know that can affect you because I have been criticized, I've been told I was fat, and the way that it affected her was, It scares me, you know, it scares me for a lot of people out there that battle an eating disorder.
After Caro's death, France recently afterward passed a law that outlaws the hiring of models who are too thin. The bill states that the activity of modeling is banned for any person whose body mass index is lower than the levels proposed by health authorities. Any company in France who decides to still hire models who do not meet the health requirement will face up to an $82,000 fine and up to 6 months in jail. The bill also states that models must meet a BMI of at least 18, which means that a 5'7" model would need to weigh about 121 pounds to have the capability to be hired as a model. I believe that this is a smart idea and a good starting point to help minimize the eating disorder epidemic in modeling agencies. I now think that the United States should pass the same law.
Vogue is known for being the top prestige name in regards to fashion. It gives people the knowledge about anything and everything they need to know about the ins and outs of fashion and what the latest trends are for each season. Vogue is the fashion at its finest. Everyone who is someone strives to be in Vogue. This is where the problem begins. Christy Clements, former editor of Vogue, gives an inside look into the toxic world of modeling and how the business runs. The industry of modeling is getting worse, and the drastic measures models are taking in order to rise to the top are hardly giving them enough energy to merely stand upright.
Christy knows firsthand of the vicious cycle of the modeling business. If a model puts on any weight, she will get reprimanded by her agency. So models begin to excessively diet, lose the weight, and then will get praised with compliments on how much better she looks. The obsessive thoughts that an eating disorder gives you leaves the model thinking that losing more weight will make her more desirable. The horrible problem with this is that no one, agencies or colleagues, will tell her to stop and get help.
The longer I worked with models, the more the food deprivation became obvious. Cigarettes and Diet Coke were dietary staples. Sometimes you would see the telltale signs of anorexia, where a girl develops a light fuzz on her face and her arms as her body struggles to stay warm. I have never in all my career heard a model say, "I'm hot," even if you wrapped her up in fur and put her in the middle of the desert.
A few years later, we booked another Russian girl, who was also starving herself, on a trip to Marrakesh. When the team went out to dinner at night, she ordered nothing, but then hunger would get the better of her, and she would pick small pieces of food off other people's plates. I've seen it happen on many trips. The models somehow rationalize that if they didn't order anything, then they didn't take in any calories. They can tell their booker at the agency before they sleep that they only had a salad. By the end of the trip, she didn't even have enough energy to sit up. She could barely open her eyes. We actually had to lie her down next to a fountain to get the last shot.
In 2004, a fashion season in which the girls were expected to be bone thin, I was having lunch in New York with a top agent who expressed her concern to me, as she did not want to be the one to expose the conspiracy. "It's getting very serious," she said. She lowered her tone and glanced around to see if anyone at the nearby tables could hear. "The top casting directors are demanding that they be thinner and thinner. I've got 4 girls in the hospital, and a couple of others have resorted to eating tissues. Apparently, they swell up and fill your stomach."
Georgina Wilkins was scouted into the modeling industry at age 15. Her mother was a little wary about allowing her daughter to work in Tokyo for the next few months, but allowed her to anyway. Little did the Wilkins know was that their daughter, Georgina, would be battling anorexia for the next 7 years of her life. They measured every single part of her body. The only condition to get the job was that Georgina had to lose 3 inches from her hips and 1 inch from her waist. She was already underweight to begin with, and as Georgina states, losing weight became her only mission. She was only 86 pounds and was 5 feet 10 inches, yet she was the biggest girl when she arrived in Tokyo. Georgina was constantly told that the skinnier girls would be getting bookings before her and that she wouldn't even be able to model for jewelry companies because her fingers were too fat. This obsession became deadly, and Georgina's kidneys began to fail.
I live my life in chains, got my hands in chains, and I can't stick with a car to the guy, but I do like this. I must insist that a girl's got more to do than be the way you think a woman should. I'm taking it into my own hands. In this man's land, I can't understand why I'm taking command. I've had enough.
She told the Daily Mail about her lips and fingers were blue because her heart was working so hard to pump blood throughout her whole body, and that her makeup artist would have to disguise it with concealer. I think it's ridiculous that it was blatantly obvious that Georgina was suffering, and all the modeling agencies would do was try and cover it up with makeup.
Georgina says that too often I'd been told by agents and stylists, you could do much better if you were a bit smaller, or you've got so much potential, but it would be a good idea for you to join a gym. This sort of language seeps deep into a young girl's thoughts.
Tyra Banks, one of the most famous women in the fashion world, speaks out about the modeling industry and explains how Vogue is stepping up and making a change. The editors of Vogue's 19 International Edition have pledged to prohibit models from their pages who appear to have an eating disorder. Vogue, being one of the top modeling and fashion industries in the world, are trying to help create healthy working conditions backstage for models. I think that since this article was written 3 years ago, society needs more modeling companies standing up for their models' health instead of lowering self-esteem by constant ridicule in regards to their weight.
Tyra tells the Daily Beast about her own career as a model and how if she were to have been born years later, her career probably wouldn't have been as successful as it was. She explains how she would have been considered overweight, and she's seen the modeling industry become harsher on models as the years went on.
Tyra explains how when she was a teenager and starting to get into the modeling industry, the average sizes for models were 4 to 6. Now in 2016, young women are expected to be a size 00. Tyra, in her interview with the Daily Beat, says that in my early 20s, I was a size 4, but then I started to get curvy. My agency gave my mom a list of designers that didn't want to book me in their fashion shows anymore. In order to continue working, I would have had to fight Mother Nature and get used to depriving myself of nutrition.
Along with Tyra, Aerie, a lingerie store, has launched Aerie Real, a spring 2014 ad campaign that only contains unretouched photos of real women. Aerie decided to keep every little stretch mark, tattoo, and stomach that would normally be seen as an imperfection by other brands and magazines. Girls aged 15 to 21 are still highly influenced by the images of females they see in the media. Of course, photoshopped women do not exist in real life, and by showing these realistic women, it could help society as a whole develop a better and healthier outlook on their own bodies.